He has put down the mighty from their seat, and exalted the humble. He has filled the hungry with good things, and the rich has sent away empty. For I know that the cherubim and the earthen pair were worse than the seraphim, who was a virgin, came from God.
Thank you.
extend your mercy to those who know you.
Wisdom.
Give the blessing.
Blessed is Christ, O God, the one who is holy, slender, and forever.
Amen. O God, strengthen the true faith forever and ever.
Most holy Theotokos, save us.
More honorable than the cherubim, and the uncomparable glories than the seraphim. O Virgin, give birth to God the Word. You join the Theotokos with magnified.
Glory to you, Christ, God the Lord. And of all the saints, for Christ is good and loves us all. expression, look with compassion on us and on this Holy Church and Master, and show us, and those who pray with us, the riches of your tender mercy. All to you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, is the all glory and the worship, now and ever and forever.
Amen. procession will multiply you. And so, after patient waiting, Abraham obtained what God had promised. Men swear by someone greater than themselves. An oath gives firmness to a promise and puts an end to all argument. God, wishing to give the heirs of his promise even clearer evidence that his purpose would not change, guaranteed it by oath, so that by two things that are unchangeable, in which he could not lie, we who have taken refuge in him might be strongly encouraged to seize the hope which is placed before us. Like a sure and firm anchor, that hope extends beyond the veil through which Jesus, our forerunner, has entered on our behalf, being made high priest forever according to the order of Melchizedek.
They love
left the district and began a journey through Galilee, but Jesus did not want anyone to know about it. He was teaching his disciples in this way: the Son of Man is going to be delivered into the hands of men, who will put him to death. 3 days after his death, he will rise.
Glory to you, Lord. Glory to you. The Holy Spirit shall come upon you, and the power of the Most High, shall overshadow you.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. Glory to Jesus Christ. Slava Jesus Christus. Dear brothers and sisters, we continue this reflection on the prayer before the communion, the prayer that we all say, priest and lay persons, all of us, all the faithful, when we approach the Holy Eucharist, and when we receive the Holy Body and Blood of Jesus Christ. This is the prayer that really accompanies us, leads our way towards the resurrection, towards Pascha. So we have already reflected on the first lines, on the first paragraphs. Let's move on and let's look at what the prayer has to offer to us today. And indeed, as we read this prayer, we see that there are two characters. And all of us are invited to look at these two characters and to learn something from them. They indeed those examples. One is to follow and another one is to avoid. Why will not reveal your mysteries to your enemies? Nor will I give a kiss as did Judas, but like the thief I profess you. Remember me, O Lord, when you come into your kingdom. So these two characters are, of course, Judas and that thief. And we know that Judas was that impenitent disciple. He spent with Jesus those 3 years, probably. He learned something from Jesus. He looked at Jesus. He enjoyed the company of Jesus Christ. And there is this other penitent thief who tells, being on the cross, remember me, O Master, when you come into your kingdom. Why do we reflect on these two characters when we approach the communion? Of course, we don't look at Judas, we don't follow his example, but we need to look at the thief, at the penitent thief. And who was that thief? And immediately we need to think about that passion of Jesus Christ on the cross, on that hill of Golgotha. And there is Jesus Christ, but along with him there are other two criminals that are crucified on the cross. And one on the right side and another one on the left side. And it is especially the Gospel of Luke that tells this scene, what happens, how do they talk to Jesus Christ. And what is striking in this episode is that irony. Jesus Christ had those 12. One betrayed him, one sold Jesus Christ, which is Judas. Other 10 disciples fled from Jesus Christ during the moment of passion. Peter, who was supposed to be the rock, did not follow Jesus Christ, but he was hiding himself. And only one disciple was at the cross, who is John, the evangelist, according to the Gospel of John. Where are the disciples? And this is an irony. Those who enjoy the presence of Jesus Christ, those who stay with him, are not there in the moment when Jesus needs that the most. In the moment when Jesus needs that support, and we can also say that, of course, Jesus Christ is the Lord, divine nature, etc. But here Jesus Christ suffered as a man, just like any other man. He felt all the pain, all the suffering of being nailed to the cross. So in that moment, when he needed that support, there was not so much support. And that is why it is striking to look at this thief. There is that thief. And you know that crucifixion was one of the degrading, humiliating punishments back in those days. And the crucifixion was a good deterrent for all the other people who were thinking to do some crime. So on the cross, only the cruelest criminals were crucified. The slaves, the rebels, and those who committed the most violent crimes. So this man who is crucified along with Jesus Christ, he was not just like a regular thief. He did not steal $100. He did much more. He was one of the most violent criminals. That's why he was on the cross. And this is the irony that this man, who is justly on the cross, asked for forgiveness. He is a truly penitent. And he asked for the mercy. Remember me, O Lord, when you come into your kingdom. He asked for something that probably he does not deserve. He himself says on the cross that we are crucified here justly for what we have done in our lives. So that punishment is something that he deserves. This is what he says to this other criminal on the cross. But he asks for the mercy. He needs the mercy. And he has that confidence to ask for the mercy. Remember me, O Lord, when you come into your kingdom. How does Jesus Christ reply to this man? And it's beautiful that Jesus answered. Truly I say to you, today you will be with me in paradise. Today. Jesus Christ does not believe. He does not tell him, okay, in a year something could happen. Or in 10 years something could happen. Jesus Christ does not believe in that response. Today you will be with me in paradise. Right away. And you know, when we will be looking at the cross again during the Holy Friday, this is one of the prayers that we will be singing during the Plashanitsa, during the whole Holy Shroud. The wise thief, you did make worthy of paradise in a single moment. O Lord, by the wood of your cross, illumine me as well and save me. How is this thief described? With two beautiful adjectives. He is wise and worthy. But he is the criminal. He is on the cross. That's why he did something wrong, something really bad. And he is called, according to the tradition, the wise thief, who was made by the Lord worthy of paradise. And according to the church tradition, he is the one who, that is called Saint Dismas, not one of the saints. That moment of penitence operated a big change. Something important happened. So as we see this beautiful prayer before the communion, we are reminded to look at this example. To look at this model of St. Dismas, to look at this thief, because he combines two important virtues. And these are the virtues that we are invited to have now when we approach the communion, when we approach the Holy Confession also. The virtue of repentance, but also the confidence. Sometimes we stress too much the repentance. We focus only, be merciful to me, and it is true. But when we repent, we need also to feel the confidence. The confidence in the Lord that he can forgive. And that he can say the same words that he said to that thief. Today you will be with me in paradise. Repentance and confidence. Two important virtues when we approach the communion. As we move on with this prayer, we read other words. May the partaking of your holy mysteries, O Lord, be not for my judgment or condemnation, but for the healing of soul and body. Healing of soul and body. And often as we look at the Bible, at the scriptures, we see that there are usually those two ways. And there is not a third way, a fourth way, or fifth way. There are five wise women and five other women that were not wise. there is the seed that grows, that falls in the ground and produces the fruit, and another seed that does not produce the fruit. As we look at other books in the Bible, we see that there is the way that the righteous walk in, another way that those who are not righteous walk in. There are usually those two ways. And as we look at the scripture more in detail, we see that there are only two ways. One that leads to the life, and another one that does not lead to the life, but something which is opposite to the life. Two ways. May the partaking of your holy mysteries, Lord, be not for my judgment and condemnation, but for the healing of soul and body. And there are these two ways also here as we approach the Holy Communion. And it is hard for many of us, and for me personally, to look at that first part. Be not for my judgment and condemnation, because all of us priests would like to have many people in the church, many people that come for the Holy Communion, etc. We also look at those numbers. But it looks like the Spirit is trying to present an important message. One needs to try to approach that communion in the worthy manner. In the worthy manner, what does that word mean to be worthy? Who is really worthy? When the priest says that prayer before the great entrance with the gifts, the priest says, no one is worthy. And in the confession, the priest says, and I, a priest, although unworthy. So, we say to us that we are not really worthy, but the worthy does not mean to be perfect. Not because there can be a misinterpretation. The worthy does not mean to be perfect. And the worthy does not mean to be sinless. But maybe the worthy means is the one who is penitent, who has that virtue of penance, who approaches the communion, being aware of the humanity that we all have, that we all share. And who is really worthy, who is really penitent. Probably in these few years of the priestly ministry, something that really touched me personally, before being a priest, just as being a Christian, is to see the tears during the confession. Because in that moment, you realize how the grace of the Lord touched that person. How the grace of the Lord touched the heart of that person. And you know, sometimes we say that, no, it's important, that penitence, that repentance, and this is what I'm trying to say to me, first of all, and to my community. But when one is really penitent, we can see the greatness of that person. When one is penitent, let's look again at that thief who is on the cross, who is there for a reason. He did something for effect. Remember me, O Lord, when you come into your kingdom. 2,000 years later, we still reflect on that example. And we are still invited to look at this man in the moment when he became penitent, repentant. It is in that moment that he becomes great. He becomes that moment. And that is why we invited to look at him. We invited to learn from him. Because he combines those two virtues, repentance and confidence in the Lord. That the Lord can help, that the Lord can forgive, that the Lord can save. Today, as we will be approaching this Holy Communion, today, but any other day, let's think about those two things. I approach as a penitent, but I have big trust in the Lord, that the Lord can make me worthy, that I receive truly the precious blood of Lord Jesus Christ, and this is something that I need. This is something that I need for my life, for my heart, for my soul, for my spiritual life. Glory to Jesus Christ. Glory to him.
Let us all say with our whole soul and with our whole mind, let us pray.
these supplications in charity from these before the throne of your majesty. Safeguard them from every visible and invisible enemy, from every misfortune, distress, and affliction. Spare them from illness and grant them health and long life. Let us all see your Lord here and hear mercy. Of the true faith, always and ever and forever.
Amen. That we may receive, the King of all. It is that we ask for it. Amen.
God, you created us and brought us into this life. You have shown us ways to salvation and have bestowed on us the revelation of heavenly mysteries. You yourself have appointed us to this service by the power of your Holy Spirit. Therefore, Lord, be pleased to make us servants of your new covenant and ministers of your holy mysteries. According to your abundant mercy, receive us as we draw near your holy altar, so that we may be worthy to offer you the spiritual and bodily sacrifice for the sins and for the people's failings. Receive it as a fragrant aroma upon your holy heaven and mystical altar, and send down upon us in return the grace of your Holy Spirit. Look upon us, O God, and behold this our worship, and accept it as you accepted the gifts of Abel, the sacrifices of Noah, the first fruits of Abraham, the priesthood of Moses and Aaron, and the peace offerings of Samuel. Just as you accepted this true worship from the hands of your apostles, now, O Lord, in your goodness, accept these gifts from the hands of us sinners. May we, who have been made worthy to minister without blame at your holy altar, obtain the reward of faithful and wise stewards on the fearsome day of your just retribution. Grant through the mercies of your only begotten Son, with whom you are blessed together with the all holy good and the great in spirit, now and ever and forever.
Able to proclaim your light, O God, to make known all your praises, or to recount
Son, all the light of each and every age, O Master of all, Lord of heaven and earth, and of all creation, both visible and invisible, enthroned in glory yet fathoming the depth, eternal, invisible, incomprehensible, boundless, and changeless. Father, our great God, Simeon, and Lord Jesus Christ, you are revealed through him, who is our hope, the image of your goodness, and the silver in your likeness. He is the living fruit, true God, eternal wisdom, life, sanctification, power, and the true light, to whom the Holy Spirit has been revealed, the Spirit of truth, the gift of filial adoption, the pledge of our future inheritance, the crossroads of eternal blessings, the life-creating power and wellspring of sanctification, to whom every rational and intelligent creature is empowered to worship you, and to offer you an unending hymn of praise, all creation serves you, angels, archangels, thrones, dominions, principalities, virtues, powers, and the many high cherubim praise you. You are surrounded by the six-winged seraphim. Two wings cover their face, two they feet, and with two they fly, and they call one to another with never-ending and never-silent hymns of praise.
Singing, shouting, crying aloud, and sing the triumph of him.
Sustaining all things by his powerful word, he did not deem equality with you, God and Father, something to be grasped. Rather, while remaining everlasting God, he appeared on earth and lived among men. In becoming incarnate from the Holy Virgin, he emptied himself, taking the form of a slave, conforming himself to the lowliness of our body, that he might conform us to the image of his glory. For since through a man sin entered the world, and through sin death, so it pleased your only begotten Son, who is in your bosom, God and Father, to be born of a woman, the Holy Theotokos and ever Virgin Mary, to be born under the law, to condemn sin in his flesh, so that those who are dead in Adam might be brought to life in him, your Christ. Living in this world, he gave us precepts for salvation, turned us away from the deceit of idols, and brought us to know you, true God and Father. He purchased us for himself as a chosen people, a royal priesthood, and a holy nation. Cleansing us with water and sanctifying us with the Holy Spirit, he surrendered himself as a ransom to death, by which we were held captive, sold into slavery under sin, descending by the cross into Hades to fulfill all things in himself. He freed us from death, despair, and rose on the third day, preparing the way for the resurrection of all flesh from the dead. Since corruption could not keep the oath of life in its clutches, he became the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep, the firstborn of the dead, that in all things he might have preeminence over all. Ascending into heaven, he has taken his seat at the right hand of your majesty on high, and will come to reward everyone according to his works. But he left us these memorials of his same passion, which we have prepared according to his command. For when he was about to go forth to his voluntary, ever memorable, and life-creating death, on the night when
he surrendered himself for the life of the world, he took bread into his holy and unpure hands and presented it to you, God and Father. He gave thanks, blessed, sanctified, broke, and gave it to his holy disciples and apostles, saying, Take it, this is my body which is broken for you, for the remission of sins.
Amen.
Likewise, taking the chalice of the fruit of the vine, he mixed it, gave thanks, blessed, sanctified, and gave it to his holy disciples and apostles, saying, Drink of this, all of you, this is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many, for the remission of sins.
Amen.
Do this in remembrance of me, for as often as you eat this bread and drink this chalice, you proclaim my death and profess my resurrection. Therefore, Master, we also remember his same passion, the life-creating cross, the three-day burial, the resurrection from the dead, the ascension into heaven, the enthronement at your right hand, God and Father, and his glorious and fearsome second coming.
Offering you your own from your own holy and
Remember all your people, Lord our God, and upon all of them pour out your rich mercy, granting every petition which leads to salvation. Yourself, O God, remember those whom we have not remembered, whether through ignorance or forgetfulness or multitude of names. We know the each, the name of each, you know each of them, even from their mother's womb. For you, O Lord, are the help of the helpless, the hope of the hopeless, the savior of the storm-tossed, the harbor of voyagers, and the healer of the sick. We all things to all people, for you know each of them and their requests, each home and its needs. O Lord, deliver this city and every city and community from plague, famine, earthquake, flood, fire, violence, foreign invasion, and civil war. Remember for us, O Lord, remember our Holy Father Francis, Pope of Rome, our most reverend Metropolitan William, our God, loving Bishop Kurt, preserve them for your holy churches in peace, sweet, young, and come for many years, as they faithfully impart the word of your truth. Remember, Lord, the entire episcopate of the true deliverers from faithful and power the word of your truth. Remember also my unworthiness, O Lord, according to the abundance of your mercies. Forgive me every transgression, voluntary and involuntary. And despite my sins, do not withhold any grace of your Holy Spirit from these gifts offered here. Remember, Lord, the presbytery, the diaconate in Christ, and every holy order. Let none of us who surround your holy altar be put to shame. Visit us in your goodness, O Lord. Reveal yourself to us in your rich compassion. Grant us a helpful and agreeable climate and gentle showers upon the earth that it may be fruitful. And crown the cycle of the seasons with your kindness. By the power of your Holy Spirit, bring an end to schism in the churches, extinguish the raging of the nations, and quickly put down the absurdities of heresy. Accept us all into your kingdom, showing us to be children of the light and of the day. Grant us your peace and love, O Lord, our God, for you have given us everything. And grant that with one voice and one heart, you may glorify and praise the most honored and magnificent name, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and ever and forever. As you have accepted these gifts, for our God, purify us from every defilement of flesh and spirit. Teach us to grow perfect in holiness, through fear of you, so that with the pure testimony of our conscience, we may receive a portion of your holy gifts, and be united to the holy body and blood of your Christ. Receive them worthily, may we have Christ living in our hearts, and become temples of your Holy Spirit. Especially, our God, let none of us become guilty nor weakened in soul or body by partaking of these awesome and heavenly mysteries of yours unworthily. Rather, grant, O Lord, that even until our last breath, we may worthily receive a portion of your holy gifts as a provision for the journey to eternal life and for an acceptable defense before the fearsome judgment seat of your Christ. Then, together with all the saints who have pleased you since time began, may we become partakers of the eternal blessings which you have prepared for those who love you, O Lord. And make us worthy, O Master, that we may with confidence and without condemnation echo you, Father, out of heaven and stream.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done. Give us this day our daily bread.
keep them from every good work, and make them worthy to partake of this your most pure and life-creating mysteries, without condemnation, for the remission of their sins and for communion of the Holy Spirit. Through the grace, the mercies, and the loving kindness of your only begotten Son, we throw your blessed together with your own holy, good, and life-creating Spirit, now and ever and forever.
Thank you. communion of our souls and bodies. You, O Master of all, granted the communion of the holy body and blood of your Christ, may bring about in us a faith that cannot be confounded, a love that does not pretend, a wisdom that overflows the healing of our souls and bodies, the defeat of every enemy, the full observance of your commandments, and an acceptable defense before the fearsome judgment seat of Christ. For your sanctification, we give glory to you, for the Son and Holy Spirit, now and ever and forever. Schedule at 9 a.m. the Matins, and 9:30 the Divine Liturgy. As many of you know, I have been away for 2 days, only 48 hours, and I have shared this already yesterday with the people that came for the liturgy, but I just would like to share this with you. I had for the first time that feeling that you are coming back home. And it is a good feeling. We traveled almost 4 hours, and then I stopped at this gas station right at the border between Connecticut and New York, and I said, oh, finally I'm close to home. And although they teach us to not be attached to any place where the bishop sends us, still the place where the priest serves, it is his home. So it's good to be home, it's good to be back home, because I had a feeling like we went for the vacation, because it was far away from here. But anyway, it's good to be home, it's good to see all of you. And may God bless you, all the beloved ones, all those for whom we pray, and we hear always someone for whom we pray, and God bless us all. To all our brothers and sisters, to all the Christians of the true faith, grant, O Lord,